Hi, I'm Andy Findlay, and today we're on the beautiful Packington Summers fishery on Molins Pool. The method's come a long way in the last 20 years, and I'm going to show you everything you need to know. So let's go and have a look. The most important thing about method fishing is bait preparation. Over the years, the 2mm pellets have come in slightly different, and in that time I've learned and used all sorts of different pellets to go on the method, and I think now I've sorted out, depending on the type of pellet that comes in, exactly how to soak them, add binders to them if need be. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to show you the way I prepare them for today's fishing, using the current batch of 2mm thin perfect pellets that are going to go on my method. So what I do to start with, I pour about a pint of 2mm pellets into an EVA bowl. About a pint of pellets is about right for a start. I mean, when they're soaked up, It'll double in size to about 2 pints, and that's sometimes enough for half the day in the summer. Or if it's in cooler times or the fishing's hard, it's going to do you all day. The total prep time for these pellets is going to be about an hour onwards. Anything after an hour, they get better as the time goes on, but you need a minimum of an hour to soak. So there you go, I've poured about a pint of pellets in the bottom of my bowl. And what I'm going to do now is add a level helping of water just to cover the pellets. Now you can see I've put too much water in there, so what I'm going to do, I'm just going to pour a bit out until the level with the pellets. Still a bit too much in there. Bit more. And there you go, that's it. If anything, that's just above the pellet level, and that's just about perfect for this batch of pellets. And what they need now is time to soak. I wouldn't just forget about them for the hour soaking time. You need to be with them, because what you don't want to do is just leave them like that and come back in about an hour's time and they'll be too wet, because all the water below the pellets will make the pellets, the lower level of pellets, too sticky. So just keep an eye on them, and as time goes by, it's about every 10 to 15 minutes after you've added the water, you need to give them a quick shake and get the water back on top of the pellets, just by shaking the bowl, really. The bowl's even better than bait boxes. They make the pellet prep very easy. So that's basically it for now, but as you're setting up your gear, then you want to just keep an eye on your pellets and just keep turning them over as you're setting up your gear. You know, don't leave them to just soak in, else they'll be too wet at the bottom. I keep talking about the current batch of 2mm pellets. Sometimes they come different. These pellets, the recent batch of 2mm pellets that Sonu do, are absolutely perfect. You don't need to add any binder whatsoever. But you'll probably find yourself, you'll be preparing them like this and still not quite sticky enough to go on the feeder. So for that, for them sort of pellets, you're going to need some binder. This is what I use for that type of pellet. If you have this problem with them not sticking enough, and it's just a ground bait and pellet binder that Sonu do, and they prepare them in exactly the same way as what I've just talked about, leveling with water. And as they've dried up after this hour, what I've talked about, then you need to add this, about a tablespoon of binder to a pint of pellets, and just sprinkle it on top of the soaked pellets and just shake it about inside, and you know, work it in with your hands, and you'll find that it'll start to go sticky, which is just right to go on the method. Before I left the house this morning, just to speed things up a bit, I've already done this at home before I left the house, prepared them over the hour. And so I've got a batch here that I've done earlier. And as you can see, that amount of pellets that I've put in that bowl there has swollen up to that. So there's quite a lot of pellets in there. This is going to last me about 2 to 3 hours of the match, I would have thought. But you can see they've dried up from the hard state in the bags. But they're nice and wet, and that's what you need. There's all sorts of different ways of preparing these pellets, but this is the best way I've found through all the years. I've been fishing the method for 30 years, believe it or not. And this is the best way to prepare them. You want the pellet soft right through. When I squeeze them, there's no hardness in the pellet at all. And they're sticky enough on their own. I can just squeeze them lightly and they stick together. There's a lot to use in the mould. You know, you want to trap air in them when they're on the feeder. Don't squeeze them too hard on the feeder, but that's why you need them quite sticky. But as I say, these recent batch are perfect with no binder at all. But if they're not sticky enough, you don't want to be cramming them down on the feeder with your mould. You want to be using a bit of binder and just lightly putting them on with the mould to leave some air in there, because it's the air escaping which makes the pellets break up. So there's no ground bait in my bait prep for method fishing now. It's all 2mm pellets. I don't need to use anything else. It's in my mind that it's the best bait. It holds fish there. You know, if you've not had a bite, you retrieve your feeder in, your pellets are left there for a fish to come in and eat it, and that's how you build your peg up. It gets big fish in your peg, you know, for later on in the day if you're not catching early. So that brings me nicely onto the hook baits. Now, there's all sorts of different hook baits for method fishing. There's wafters, boilies, bandoms, the whole lot, and they all catch fish. They're all good, different flavours, you know, you can use what you like. And they all catch fish. Some really good anglers swear by them, they use them all the time. But I don't. I don't use anything bright or hard as a hook bait on the method. All I use is an expander pellet. Believe it or not, it's 1/4mm. It's a small bait. I think you start putting 8-10mm baits in a small method especially, it's too big and it's too obvious for the carp, and a lot of them leave it alone. All right, on the good days, they'll take the tip round on anything really, but on them hard days, the middle of the matches, you know, when it's not going that well, the middle hours, expander pellet is the best bait in my opinion. And really these days, again, over the years, I've used every single hook bait you can use on the method. But up until recently, say the last 5 years, the only bait I've had on my hair rig on the method is an expander pellet. It's as simple as that. It's the best bait in my opinion. Without expander being the best hook bait for me on the method, it's got to be the right expander. So now I've brought out a pro expander, it's called. A lot of you use these and get on really well with them. And they're very easy to prepare just by soaking them in water. They're a sinking pellet, but they'll need at least an hour, maybe 2 hours to soften right through. So the prep to these is just by pouring them in a bowl of water. You can do it the night before, you can do it in the morning before you match. So I'd advise doing it just before you leave the house, or the night before, and pour them in the fridge to soak overnight. But I've got a better way. I had the conversation with Des, it's his brainchild behind these pellets, and he used to tell me that if you kept your water cold, then the pellet's even firmer, and that's what you're after with method fishing. You're cramming bait on the method and cramming the expander inside, so you don't want it to break up, so you want a firm, rubbery expander. So Des used to tell me that if you kept your water cold as you soaked it in the expander, then you get a firmer pellet. Well, that made me come up with the idea of using a flask. And the prep is really simple, it really is. Like I said, you need to soak them really at home or the night before, or at least in the morning before you set off. And that's what I do. But all I do in the morning, I get a few ice cubes out of the freezer, pop them in the flask, and then enough expanders for the day's fishing, which isn't that many to be fair. You don't want to be wasting them. I've poured about, I don't know how many there is there, 200 or so. you're not going to use all them in any day's feed of fishing, don't matter how good it is. So, you know, you can put that many pellets, just pour them in the flask after your ice cubes, and then half fill the flask with water. So you've got two ice cubes, about 200 4mm expanders, pro expanders, and then half a flask of water in there. And then this is in the morning before you leave the house, and then just put the top on. So before the match, or as I'm fishing the match, I've just got a small bait box like so, and I just keep them in the flask all day, and as I use them, I just pour a few out in my hand, just probably a dozen or so expanders, really cold that water is, and just put them in the bait box there. And you can just tip a bit of water on, just keep a bit of water in your bait box. I wouldn't immerse them, I'd just keep, you know, so they're sitting in a bit of water, that way they won't dry out. And just pop the top back on your flask and keep it on your bait tray. And as you can use them, you know, when you've used all them, you'd help yourself to a few more out of the flask. But because that water's really cold, they've been in the flask, they're really rubbery and firm. They're still soft and stay on the hook. They'll stand the pressure of the mould onto them, but you can see that I can play about with them in my fingers and they're not going to split. They're absolutely brilliant. So there you go, that's the proper way I've found about using pellets on the method feeder. It's very simple really, I've talked a lot about it, but as you keep doing it, it gets so simple and it doesn't take this long what I've been explaining, it just takes just a few minutes. Perhaps the most important thing about fishing the feeder towards an island, the method feeder, is where you decide to fish. Now this peg I've chose here, it's 49 on the Molins. I've drawn on it not long ago and won the match quite easily, so that's the reason I've sat on here today. But the peg speaks for itself really. What you've got is a nice shallow point over at the island, then you've got a nice clump of reeds, and then to the right you've got a lot of cover. And I know because the platform's not that safe to sit on next door, that means you've got a lot of room to your right, which looks really fishy, where obviously a lot of fish live. So really, the obvious place to start fishing here is tight to the island. We all know, you know, in a match, when all the anglers are around the lake, the fish back off to the island, they feel safe there. So that's the place to target. What I'm expecting, if the fish can come from the cover and I'm the first angler that they'll visit, you know, that's where I'll be fishing. So the simple way, really it is simple about clipping up, just follow a few basic steps, but it needs to be right. And it don't really matter how long it takes you to clip up, as long as you get it right in time for the start of the match. So I'm going to be using a 30 gram feeder. So for that reason, I've got a 30 gram ICS inline match lead that I've slipped on the tube. So that's the weight I'm going to be using. And I'm just going to be slowly casting across until I get tight. I'm going to start short and clip up when it lands 10 or 15 yards short. Well, that's probably landed a yard short, so I'm not far off at that. So what I'm going to do roughly, I've trapped the line with my finger, I'm just going to let about a yard of line off it and trap it again, then I'm going to clip up and then I'm going to have another cast and see how close I am this time. And I would have thought I'll be very close this next cast, but as I say, it don't matter how long it takes you, as long as you get it right. So you can see there, I'm not too worried about that, it went on the bank. But I'm glad that's happened actually, because I can tell you something here that you should never ever lose a feeder from. Just supposing that you've done that in the match and you've got a hook there, then I've got a brilliant way of getting it off the island, just in case you get there. But I'm going to unclip for a start so that I can get it off the island. And rather than sort of lose your rag and start jerking the rod back in frustration, trying to get it out of the cover of the island, all you need to do is raise your rod and just wind slowly and just keep winding, and then you just pull it off the bank like I've done there. And then I'm going to wind in about the yard I took off really, and clip up there and see if I'm right this time. Well, that's a really good tip, that. You know, if you ever get stuck, even in a tree, you've got to be fishing the method with your bait buried inside it, so your hook's not exposed to catch on something. But rather than try and get it off in your frustration, just clip the bail arm open, I mean shut rather, and just a steady pull, don't matter how hard you pull, and you'll just pull the feeder off the bank or out of the tree and it'll plop straight back in the lake. So this should be about right now, because I've had two casts. We'll see where it goes. Hit the clip, and there you go. I've got a bow in my line. It's a bit of a gust of wind then, so you can imagine once that bow in the line straightened out, I'm going to be right next to the island there. But I'm just going to have one more clip, one more cast, just to make sure I'm right. I'll make sure I'm clipped up at that same spot. But this time I'm going to try and make sure to have a straight line when the bomb hits the water. You can imagine if there's a bow in the line, and obviously if you're clipped up, the feeder's going to land closer. So you want to try and straighten your line. Again, that's why I'm going to be using a 30 gram feeder here today, and that's why I'm using a 30 gram lead to clip up with. Hit the clip, and I'm probably a yard off there, but I'm gonna settle on that until I start fishing with the feeder, because once the 30 grams feeder on with like a lot of 2mm pellets on, then that's going to increase the weight of the feeder. It'll take you a bit further over. So I'm going to settle on that now. But now there's also a very important part of the process is, once you've clipped up, you need to, there's two ways. Just supposing that you get a big fish on, you're going to have to unclip and let the fish run. It's no good trying to hold like a 10 pound fish and trying to hold it and trying to turn it, because you won't be able to either straighten your hook, or it could break your elastic if you're using an elasticated feeder, or it could even break your main line, which is the last thing you want to happen. So you need to unclip, but once you've unclipped, you're not going to know where to clip back up to unless you've marked your line or you've counted your turns. I'd recommend doing both them things really. The way to mark your line, which I've already done on this, is I've tied a sliding knot just out of 017 power line onto me reflow sinking feeder mono. You can probably see it there in between my two fingers. So that is the distance I'm fishing at. So if I have to unclip for a fish, I can let the fish go and just wind it back in, and then find my sliding knot and clip up to that again, which I've just done here. And I'm at the same length as I was before I hooked the fish. So I'm fishing straight away without having to go through the routine of clipping up again like I've already done. So that's it, I'm all clipped up. Let's get a feeder on and catch some fish. You can't go method feeder fishing without method feeders. Now, the selection I've got on my side tray here have come a long way since getting on 30 years ago, when I first come up with the flat method feeder, which basically was just a plate of lead with some wire glued on. I used to use araldite, but up until sort of, they've gone through like lots of variations over the years. But modern day, here we are today, and Preston through the years used all sorts of different designs, but this is the latest design. It's the ICS method feeder, and it's the only one I use now. I've thrown all my old homemade jobbies away, which I used to win lots of matches on back in the day when it was coming off the M-Stat feeder, when you used to have the big ball of bait around the feeder. And now it's come down to the most modern design. It's a full metal construction other than the plastic interchangeable stem that goes through the feeder. Your line's obviously threaded through there and you've got a stop bead on the end, so it makes it really versatile and means that you can swap between feeders, different sizes of feeders. That's a small size, I've just took the large size off, in several different weights, 20, 30 grams, 45 grams, even up to 60 grams. So you've got a feeder and a bomb for every sort of eventuality really, every range from short fishing to, you know, on the horizon. It's got a slot inside the weight, like the feeder's got a slot inside the base, and this is permanently attached on your line. It's just a case of slipping one off and slipping the other one on. Just going into a bit more detail with the feeder. Previous feeders have had three bars equidistant along the length of the feeder, but over the years we've found out that the middle bars interfered with the hook bait, because all my method fishing is done with the hook bait buried in. I get asked a lot of times, do you ever leave the hook bait hanging out and cast out like that? I say never, I never fish it like that, because I know I've got my pellets right, the action's right. You know, within 2 minutes, all them pellets have broke up, laying on the feeder, ready for the fish just to sup them all up. So that's where your hook bait needs to be. It appears as the fish is feeding on your feeder and it takes it without caution. That's the way the method works to me. So for that reason, we've done away with the middle bar on the smaller size feeder and splayed the bars out with enough room for your hook bait in the middle of the feeder on the larger size. That takes me on to the most modern method feeder that Preston have come up with, which I'm a really big fan of in the colder months. I wouldn't use it in September, the water's still, you know, only through around about 15 to 20 degrees, so the water's still warm, fish need a bit of bait so you're catching to compete in these matches. But once sort of, you know, November, the end of November, right through to April, May time, this is my go-to feeder. I won't be using, you know, these sizes of feeders in them months. Again, there's a mould with all these feeders, and I'm going to show you, once I get fishing, the way I load up these feeders with the mould. But a really good feeder, it's the ICM method feeder. And it's just used in line, very similar to the way I'm going to be fishing the method feeder today. F1. It's just coming towards netting range now. Just raising the rod up to get it near the surface. Oh, look at that lovely fish. Nice golden F1. Put this in the net and I'll show you how I load the method up. So the sequence of loading the feeder is really important for my sort of fishing. It's a two-stage process really after you've put the expander pellet on. So I'm going to run through that now. Obviously put the needle in the end of the quick stop, and when I select a expander, they're all the same really, they're all nice shaped and the right size what I've done, I've took them out of my flask. I'm about ready to top them up really, because I'm catching plenty of fish here, so I'm using them up. But if you hold the expander so that the two flat sides are by your finger and your thumb, and they go through by the cylinder way, you know, through the sides of the pellet, the roundness of the pellet, just put everything through and take the needle out, holding the quick stop, and just slide it back up to the quick stop. So it takes a fair bit for that to come off. You know, it will stand the pressure of the 2mm pellets being squashed onto it. But as you do this, make sure you've got tension between your feeder and your rod tip. You can see the quiver tip on my rod there. It's just bending round slightly, so that serves quite a few purposes. For a start, you're not going to get your line wrapped round your tip and snap your tip off accidentally. You've all done it, you know, any slack line, it's prone to, if there's any twist in your line, it'll want to wrap round and it'll cause you problems just as you go to cast out. But the other reason, which is just as important, is that when I've made the feeder up and I'm ready to take it out the mould, the actual tension from the tip will pull the feeder from the mould, you know, once I've pressed the button, it'll help pull it out the mould. You don't want to be holding the stem of the feeder and trying to pull it out of the mould like that, because you'll leave your bait in the mould. So the process, as I say, it's a two-stage process. Half fill the mould with the dampened pellets and put the thumb on it. It's important to compress it each time, because that means that you're getting more bait in the mould. You want to try and get as much bait in the mould as you can. Don't just fill it up and press the feeder in. Do it like this and it gets the fish confident. You catch bigger fish doing that and you're putting more bait in your peg. So I've done that, and then the next stage is to get the expander pellet right in the middle of the feeder of the mould that you're making up. And it is important, because it's going to miss the two ribs on the feeder. And then second stage then is to just fill it up as much as you can, and get your thumb on it again, just press them down. Holding it this way around, because I'm right-handed, I'm holding the feeder in the left hand and making it up with the right hand. It's easy just now to flip over the feeder and press it into the mould, on top of the mould like so, and using two thumbs, just press slightly. You don't want to be cramming this down. The way we've prepared the pellets, they're sticky enough as they are, we've not added anything to them. So you don't want to be, if you cram that down, I could press that down a lot harder, but I'd stop catching, because I'm not releasing bait into my peg. You know, it's not coming off the feeder. When I've reeled in, I'll still have a feeder full left on my feeder and I want to caught a fish. So it's important not to, you know, use all your strength to try and press it in the mould. Try and remember, just, you know, there's air inside these, each gap of these pellets is air inside, and you want that still in there. So once I've done that, we've got tension on the tip, just turn the mould upside down, and keeping your fingers underneath the feeder, as you press the button, the tension from the tip will just pull the feeder out the mould, just like so. And I've not damaged the seal around the feeder at all, that's staying on until it's on the bottom of the peg. Lines under, so I'm just pulling the rod back, and we've got to bite straight the way. It's within 2 minutes of casting out, the tip will go round. It's just F1s for now, still early in the session, but I'm hoping that the big carp will put an appearance fairly soon. But I'm happy catching these all day long. Say they're from £2 up to £4 sort of size so far. The one I lost was the biggest, as it normally is. if you've seen how quick that last bite was, it just shows you that, you know, all this prep with the pellets, soaking them for the right time, remember an hour's minimum time after you've added the water, longer's better, then you'll get your bite straight away, as this fish has proved to us. It's one of the smaller, one of probably the smallest fish I've had today. But still a nice fish all the same. They're all in great condition here at Molins, these fish are. They obviously get caught more than once in a year, but lovely condition. Of course, that fish, probably just explaining there how I was using the mould, have squashed it a bit hard on that feeder. Although the fish took straight away, you know, the feeder wasn't in the water a long time for the mix to come off it. I've still got some on my feeder there, so this is a good point. This is, if you ever come back like this, think about how the pressure you've put on with your mould, but you don't want to be making a feeder up on top of an old mix like that. So just using your baiting needle, just get rid of that before you make your next feeder full up, so that your next lot of bait will key nicely to your feeder instead of just laying on the old remnants of the last cast. Well, as predicted, it started with a run of F1s, nice fish to catch, up to £4, you know, lowest was £2, but my last three fish now have been real caught. As the day's gone on, I think they've come in and pushed the F1s out. You still get one in between now and again, but I think most bites from now on are going to be proper caught. This is going to be the biggest fish I've had on so far today. But it just shows, you know, this bait prep, accurate casting on the last feeder full has paid off. Feels a nice fish, this does. It's just surviving that first run, because I'm fishing next to that cover, they want to get in it, but once you pull them away, then they just wallow in. They're not fighting that hard once you get them off that cover. Oh, that's a nice fish, look at the size of that. Proper mirror. Oh, beauty. Stay in the landing net. All on one formal expander. So I'm just going to bait up and make up the feeder as usual. And I'll just talk you through the casting. So this is really important, this casting sequence here. You know, it's everything really. Once you get your bait prep right and your expanders right, even above that is the casting's more important than that, so it's got to be right. So the steps I take for a nice cast is 2 or 3 feet hanging down, your feeder's got to be that far down from your rod, and when you come back with your rod, you want to just miss the rod with the feeder and aim at what you target. That way the feeder will fly straight. Just before a cast, I'm going to explain the bit at the end, because that's really important. You want your feeder to land softly. It's 30 gram feeder, it's quite heavy. So you don't want that going in with the full weight of the feeder. You want to stop it and just let it drop in at the end of the cast. And that's down to your rod movement at the end. So I can't really talk about it while I do it, because it's such a short space of time. But if you can see the rod you know, the action to do with the rod, just slow the feeder down and make it plop in. So I'm just going to miss the rod with the feeder and aim it at my target. Now I'm waiting for it to hit the clip and go down with the rod. As soon as it hits the clip, straighten the line out, put the rod down underneath and I'm burying the line now without really touching the reel handle. I need to just snap the bail arm over and probably a quarter of a turn of the reel handle will send the line under. I've got a bite. I could tell that by the way the line went under. You know, a fish has got straight on that feeder. And that's the difference. If you get on that last feeder full, you'll get a bite within seconds of casting in again. And that's just how it works. It's an F1 this time. It's not a real carp, but it's going to be over 3 pounds. So you're still putting bags of weight in your keep net. Lovely fish. Well, we've had a cracking day here at Packington, caught loads of fish. So I'm just going to run you through the key points one last time, starting with loading the feeder. First thing, putting the single expander pellet on the hair rig. I've not mentioned, but once the 4mm expander pellet swells up, it's around about 6mm. So for that reason, you want about an 8mm hair. I've tried various lengths, but you seem to lose fish. The further away the pellet is from the hook when it's mounted, the more likely you are to lose fish. So I'm going in from the side, pulling the quick stop up to the pellet. And the two-stage process of loading the feeder. Half fill it, put your thumb on it, make sure the expander pellet's in the middle, and load it up again, put your thumb on it, upend the feeder onto the mould, and just let the tension in the rod pull the feeder out of the mould once you've pressed the button. And the key points of casting, you want 3 or 4 hanging down from your rod, and when you come back with the rod, you want to make sure the feeder just misses the rod, so that when you aim at what you're aiming at, then it will fly that way nice and straight, and the bit at the end hits the clip, lower the rod at the same time, goes in with a lovely splash. You know, it's just a soft splash, doesn't scare the fish, if anything it attracts them. The rod's straight on the feeder arm, because it's in front of me, pointing at where we're casting. The line's under now. I've hardly turned the handle to take the tension up, because the line was straight when the feeder landed, and I'm ready for a bite. Well, I'm glad I've caught fish on that cast. Just about running out of bait. Took off at a rate of knots, suspecting it was a proper carp, but it's mellowed down a bit now. If it is a carp, then it's a small one. would be nice to finish on it. As I say, I'm really low on bait. I've probably not even got a feeder full left. But it's been a great day. I've had a fish most casts in, not every cast. I don't think there's ever time you go fishing and you get a fish every cast. I've caught some lovely fish. I've got proper carp, about 10 pound, a few others, and a load of pump F1s. Whoa. Finish on a nice F1. So a nice fish to end on. Hope you've enjoyed it. I'll see you around.